Math 43, I had a question coming out of chapter 6, number 75. And here we were told about the percent of fat calories a person consumes each day. We were told it was normally distributed, right? Mean is 36, standard deviation is 10. So there is my distribution, right? So X is this percent of fat calories. Our units, if you want to get technical, they would be percent, but we already have that written out there. So if I talk about part A, they're asking me for my distribution because I always have to distribute 100% of my day of my, well, I have to distribute 100%, I should say. And so it's saying that the mean here is 36, the standard deviation is 10, and it's got a bell shape. That's what the N stands for. So you see me putting my variable down here on the x-axis. All right, and I labeled it X against P of X. It's analogous to when we made those PDFs in chapter 4 with tables, and we had X in the top row and P of X in the bottom row. But now they're continuous numerical variables, so we label our X and Y axes with those respectively. And then because I was told my mean was 36, you see me putting 36 under that peak. Now, if I wanted to, I could go ahead and I could do one standard deviation, two standard deviations, three above, right? And I could go one below, two below, three below. And we could scale this by tens, right? We could put 46, 56, 66, and I could go the other way, 26, 16, 6. So if you ever want to scale your x-axis, you can. But as we progress through these problems, you don't need to. You just need to make sure that you put whatever number is in play on your problem onto your graph. So I'm going to erase all this superfluous stuff. I just wanted you to see it for a moment. That's why we have the standard deviation. All right, and part B says, what's the probability, right? So as soon as we see probability, that's one of our buzzwords, capital P, something in parentheses, what's the probability that the percent of fat calories a person consumes is more than 40? So we're going to go ahead and take that phrase that said more than 40 and write X greater than 40. So you see me putting 40 here on my x-axis. I know it's not quite one deviation above the mean because, again, if our standard deviation is 10, one deviation above the mean is 46, and we're only at 40, which is fine. Now, because this says I want to see if this is more than 40, and I have that greater than symbol here, I'm going to shade all the way to the right. Because again, probability, right? It is always area under a curve. And this specific curve, wah, there we go, is the bell curve, the normal curve. So I've got that going. Let me erase some of my notes here. I want 40 or higher. So I'm starting this problem by looking inside my x-axis, right? I spot 40. I want to go higher. So that means I'm going to go 40 over to positive infinity. So that's where you see me writing these two numbers, 40 to infinity, low to high. And then the back two are always your mean and your standard deviation. And it pumps back out 35%. And that seems reasonable. The amount of area I shaded here, it's definitely less than half, right? Because if I was actually at 36, that would have been the 50th percentile, and I'm definitely less than that. So 35% seems like a reasonable number that matches my graph. So I'm happy with this answer. All right, and part C says, find the maximum number for the lower quarter of percent of fat calories. So we basically want the 25th percentile, because it asked us for the lower quartile. All right, so if I want the bottom 25%, all right, so let me put here, right, this is the 25th percentile, but as we learned back in chapter 2, this is Q1, right, or we could call it the first quartile, or sometimes we called it the lower quartile. And whenever you have a percentile problem, you're working with inverse norms. So I put in the percentile, the mean, and the standard deviation, and there's the lower quartile. All right. Thanks so much, everyone. Bye.